Sound pest management strategies for your farming operation should be based on your capability and capacity to act in a timely fashion. There's no question that the more information you have about your crops, the more effectively you can control insects, and the more you can improve your bottom line. In this program, we're going to look at three major pests of corn: corn rootworms, black cutworm, and European corn borer. We'll show how these pests can be controlled and also discuss basic information that's necessary to develop a good management program for your operation. Let's first concentrate on corn rootworm. These three insects represent corn rootworm species present in Iowa. The striped insect on the left is a western corn rootworm. This is the dominant species. It's the one most widely distributed across the state and the one that most significantly impacts our corn production. The small green insect in the center of the screen is northern corn rootworm. This one occurs over the entire state. However, it's abundant only in certain areas of central and northwestern Iowa where it causes major concern. We'll discuss northern corn rootworm a little later in the program. The large spotted insect on your right is southern corn rootworm. This species doesn't overwinter in Iowa, but migrates into the state each spring. It does feed on the silks of corn, but causes no damage to the root system. Damage such as this results when either western or northern corn rootworm infestations are present. Both species are attracted to corn, where they lay eggs during July and August. Damage such as this occurs when sufficient numbers of eggs are laid and successfully overwinter, resulting in a larval infestation the following spring. Corn rootworm larvae feed almost exclusively on the roots of corn. They do not develop on soybeans, alfalfa, sorghum, or small grains. Consequently, crop rotation has proven to be an effective means of control for those producers who can justify a non-host crop every other year. The only exception is for producers in areas of central and northwestern Iowa where the northern corn rootworm has adapted to a corn-soybean rotation. This map indicates areas where northern corn rootworm extended diapause, or two-year life cycle, occurred and was documented in 1985 or 1986. In the areas marked on the map, it may be necessary for producers to use rootworm insecticides where corn follows soybeans in 1987. For specific information on how this affects your local area, contact your county extension office and ask for publication IC-451. Only about 40% of continuous corn fields have an economic infestation of rootworms in any given year. Unless you can predict which fields are at risk, your only option is to use a soil insecticide on all your continuous corn. Scouting your fields can substantially reduce the cost of preventing rootworms in continuous corn. Thresholds for adult beetles have been established, and the techniques for scouting are available through the Extension Service. Notice that the thresholds for first-year corn are roughly one-half that of other fields. This reflects the fact that most of the beetles that are present in first-year fields are egg-laying females. Many years of experience have taught us to expect heaviest rootworm damage in second-year fields. This means that growers who scout fields will usually find the first-year fields exceed the adult beetle thresholds, and that the opportunity to reduce insecticide cost comes largely from longer rotation fields. This means that if your time is limited, you may want to concentrate on scouting efforts in fields of corn following corn and simply use an insecticide on all your second-year corn. Growers with limited resources can use the fact that second-year corn fields are most heavily infested in yet another way, by making priorities for 1987 corn rootworm control. If you haven't scouted for rootworm adult beetles and you aren't sure whether economic populations are present or not, it's best to treat all of your continuous cornfields. However, if you lack the funds to do so, then the following guidelines may help you. First of all your second year fields should be treated with a rootworm insecticide. The second priority for treatment is longer rotation fields that mature late or mature unevenly. Fields that mature evenly and at about the same time as surrounding fields are at the least risk. If you can't afford to treat all of your continuous corn, or if you are considering a relatively inexpensive and possibly less effective product on some of your acreage, I suggest prioritizing your needs along these lines. These are the 8 granular insecticides currently registered for corn rootworm control. For recommendations on product selection and application, consult publication IC404. Now let's turn our attention to black cutworm. During the past few years, researchers have made significant breakthroughs that have allowed us to monitor cutworm activity and predict with a great deal of precision the onset of damage each spring. These predictions are based on a knowledge that black cutworms do not overwinter in Iowa, but rather migrate northward from the Gulf Coast states between late March and May of each year. By using a network of pheromone traps, we are able to monitor cutworm moths as they enter Iowa, and based on accumulated degree days, predict when damage will occur and what areas of the state are most likely to be affected. You can use this information to initiate scouting at the proper time to avoid serious reductions in stand without the expense of a planting time insecticide. This is a ranking of the available locations for cutworm moths to lay eggs. If given a choice, moths will lay their eggs, or most of their eggs, where new grasses and weeds are beginning to grow. Most of the remaining eggs are laid where undisturbed crop residue is present. Very few eggs are laid on bare soil, regardless of how rough or smooth the soil surface is. It's also interesting to note that cutworm moths are not attracted to seedling corn, provided there is no grass or weed seedlings growing in the field. Obviously, tillage has a significant impact on where cutworms will lay their eggs. However, before you decide to disc all of your corn ground to avoid cutworm infestations, consider all of the trade-offs. Cutworms occur, on the average, once every 5 years, and then on a relatively small percentage of our total corn acreage. Tillage may be a viable control option for a particular piece of ground with a history of recurring cutworm problems. It is not an economical, sound option for most of our corn acreage. Corn planted into soybean stubble or other no-till situations is most likely to sustain cutworm damage. You should concentrate on scouting in such fields, but not to the exclusion of other fields that remain unworked at the time cutworms are flying. Should an economic infestation of black cutworms occur in your field, ISU recommends 1 of 4 materials. When the soil is crusty or dry, control can be improved by rotary hoeing. Loris band treated fields can be sprayed before or after rotary hoeing. Ambush, pounce, or pydrin should be applied after rotary hoeing to avoid incorporation. Cutworm infestations in most fields occur only occasionally. On the average, Iowa experiences a major cutworm outbreak once every 5 years. For this reason, Iowa State University does not recommend routine use of planting time insecticides specifically for cutworm control. Granular products registered for cutworm prevention include those on the left. The liquid synthetic pyrethroids on the right are also registered for cutworm prevention. They offer a low-cost alternative but should not be counted on to provide residual activity comparable to the granular formulations. For example, in this study, all the registered products performed well, with control ranging from 75 to 98%. And this was under a fairly heavy cutworm pressure. The liquid applications were at the top, despite their relatively short residual activity. To understand why, we need to look at cutworm moth activity. These data suggest that essentially all the cutworm egg laying had occurred by the time the crop was planted and the insecticide was applied on May 5th. With cutworm eggs and larvae already present in the field, residual activity was not important, and the products performed essentially as we would expect them to in a rescue situation. If the planting date in this study had been shifted 2 weeks to the left, say to April 22nd or 23rd, we would not expect to see the pyrethroids perform as well. In fact, under those circumstances, the data in the preceding table may well have been reversed, with the granular products providing the best control. Now let's turn our attention to European corn borer. Damage such as this was very typical across much of Iowa in 1986. This was due primarily to second-generation European corn borer. Second-generation corn borer damage can reduce yields and, in some instances, cause a significant harvest loss. Nevertheless, for most of us, trying to control second-generation corn borer can be a poor investment. Here's why. During late July and August, European corn borer moths fly and lay eggs for an extended period of time, sometimes as long as 3 or 4 weeks. This makes insecticide timing very difficult. Another problem is the level of control. Unless you can scout egg masses and then treat at the time most eggs are hatching, the level of control may drop significantly. These data illustrate that point. The time lapsed between 25 and 95% egg hatch may be no longer than 4 or 5 days in a given field, yet control may be affected as much as 50%. First-generation corn borer damage has greater impact on yields than does second-generation, although the harvest losses associated with it are not usually as high. While it is very difficult to time an insecticide application and realize a profit from treating second-generation corn borer, it is possible, through accurate scouting, to make an informative decision and realize an economic return from controlling the first generation. Scouting directions and calculation sheets, which can help you accurately estimate your return for treating first-generation corn borer, are available from your extension office. Just ask for publication PM898 and the accompanying worksheet.
A college education is an investment in the future. Iowa State University is enhancing that investment by providing a broad-based curriculum in science and technology.
I believe that my youngest daughter, Rebecca, who is an engineering student at Iowa State, is getting a first-class education. Consequently, I'm getting my money's worth just as I did when I attended Iowa State.
Today I will be discussing the importance of weed control or weed management in crop production. Whether you are farming full-time or part-time, the importance of weed control does not change dramatically. However, the techniques that you employ need to reflect the time in which you can devote to weed control and the cost of the weed control options. Let's concentrate on the why of weed control rather than the how. The reason for this is that the specific weed control recommendations must reflect a particular field: topography, soil characteristics, tillage practices and weed infestations, economic climate and availability of equipment, and other factors must be accounted for if environmentally and economically correct weed control decisions are to be made. The information we will be discussing can be adapted to your specific situation, ensuring good weed control in your farm operation. Let's first spend a little time discussing some of the background which is pertinent to Iowa. Tillage practices are changing in Iowa. As environmental issues become more important, growers are generally reducing the amount of tillage they employ in their crop production. It is important to understand that the primary function of any tillage operation is for weed control. Conventional tillage is no longer strictly moldboard plow. A majority of fall tillage is chisel plow currently. Reduced tillage does not reflect tillage technique, but refers to the amount of crop residue left on the soil surface. Approximately 30% of the row crop acres in Iowa have at least 35% crop residue on the soil surface after the tillage operation. No tillage has been increasing slowly in Iowa and currently encompasses approximately 5% of the corn and soybean acres. Weed control is the major concern of the producer when considering a reduction in the amount of tillage. We can control weeds economically in any tillage system. The critical issue is residue management. You must consider that as the level of crop residue increases, the management skill must increase. Herbicide usage has not changed dramatically in the last decade. Although there are many new herbicides, essentially we are treating all of the corn and soybean acres at least once every season. Soil-applied herbicides with residual properties which ensure season-long weed control are the most popular. These prophylactic treatments do not allow the use of weed scouting techniques, which may save money. Recently, post-emergence herbicides have become more popular. This is the result of integrated pest management and the development of new herbicides which are very effective when applied post-emergence. Pre-plant incorporation of herbicides has continued to be popular, even though the trend toward reduced tillage can potentially make incorporation more difficult. The low cost of many widely used pre-plant incorporation herbicides will likely serve to maintain this important use pattern. Iowa growers currently spend an average of $18 to $25 per acre on herbicides. However, most growers do not rely solely on herbicidal weed control. The weed control results from herbicides will vary upon the weather, so growers still rotary hoe and cultivate. Unfortunately, the mechanical weed control practices are not done often in a manner which allows for the most consistent results. Growers may cultivate when none is needed, or may cultivate too deeply. This serves to bring weed seeds to an environment where they can germinate and also serves to dilute the herbicide treatment, thus reducing the potential effectiveness of that herbicide. Herbicides are popular for weed control because they replace manpower. Herbicides also allow growers to farm larger amounts of land effectively and efficiently. Herbicides improve the consistency of weed control in reduced and no-till programs. One of the critical arguments when considering weed control is how much is actually needed. Generally, growers feel that it is necessary to achieve 100% weed control for the complete season. While aesthetically pleasing, this level of weed control is not physiologically important, and achieving 100% weed control may be economically prohibitive. Research in weed control has documented several key points. The level of weed control which is economically rewarding is usually not as high as 100%. Further, weed control throughout the season is not needed and may represent more of a problem than a benefit. Generally, if you can control weeds for 7 weeks after crop emergence, weeds which germinate after that 7 weeks will not be economically important. If, on the other hand, you plan on using a post-emergence herbicide, you can allow weeds to grow with the crop for an average of 3 weeks before control is necessary. If you then control weeds, the 3 weeks of growth will not have economically affected the crop. Weeds can interfere with the crop in several manners: harvestability, quality, and yield. The latter, yield, is most important. Weeds cause considerable loss of yields through competition. The competition is for water, light, space, nutrients, and other essential items for growth. However, not all weeds compete in the same manner, the same amount, or with the same results. This is a stylized weed crop competition curve. The y-axis is the response of crop yield. The x-axis is weed density. Weed density increases as you move left to right. That is, there are more weeds as you move to the right. Crop yield increases as you move higher on the y-axis. The curve is essentially suggesting that as the weed density increases, the potential crop yield decreases. However, if we look closely at this curve, we can begin to understand the crop-weed relationship. Note the flat part of the curve which is close to the y-axis. This demonstrates that at low weed populations, the crop can effectively compete with weeds without any significant loss of yield. However, as the weed pressure increases slightly, the potential yield drops rapidly. The place where this yield breaks could be noted as the economic threshold. If you could predict this point, then you would know when to use a herbicide. Unfortunately, this point is not easily predicted. The level of weed population which results in a yield loss will change depending on the type of weed, the growth conditions, and the duration of competition. Certain weeds are very competitive, and it does not require many weeds before an economic loss is obtained. For these weeds, the flat area on the competition curve would be very short. An example of a very competitive weed would be cucklebur. For other weeds which are not inherently very competitive, the flat part of the competition curve would be longer. An example of a non-competitive weed would be Venice mallow. Note that the shape of the curve will also change depending on the weather. If crops are stressed, it will not take very much weed pressure before the potential yield begins to drop. If growing conditions are good, on the other hand, crops will compete aggressively with the weeds, and it will take many weeds before the yield begins to drop off. In summary, the amount of yield reduction is dependent upon several things: the weed species, the population timing, that is, when in the season the weeds and crop interact, the population duration or length of competition, and the population density. You need to consider each of these when considering the economics of a weed control program. Each of these contribute to a weed control program and should be considered when developing the most economic weed control plan. You can develop a balance sheet for each of these areas and determine whether they contribute to your weed control program, detract, or have no effect on your overall weed control. If you plan on an extensive tillage program, this will have a very positive impact on weed control. If you are in a no-till program, you will need to determine other ways to control weeds. Secondary tillage is an extremely important component for an overall weed control program. You must be objective and evaluate your ability to rotary hoe and cultivate when determining whether this is a positive component of your weed control program. It is crucial that these tillage operations be accomplished in a timely fashion if they are to be most effective. Crop rotation is another important tool for weed control. A general rule of thumb is that weeds with a growth habit which is similar to the crops are more difficult to control. Grass weeds, such as giant foxtail, are most difficult to control in corn. Similarly, velvet leaf is more difficult to control in soybeans. Thus, rotating your crops on a basis of weed control need is an effective tool for controlling weeds. Herbicides are designed to control weeds for a finite period and then degrade such that the environment is not harmed. If herbicides stayed active in the soils for longer periods, pollution would become a major problem. Generally, most herbicides will provide approximately 6 to 8 weeks of weed control. However, weeds can germinate later than this and become problems unless some means of control is utilized. The later weed control is a result of crops competing with those weeds. By establishing the crop so that it is vigorous and aggressive, you are ensuring that you will have an effective weed control program after the herbicide is no longer active. After you have considered all of these components discussed, then it is appropriate to consider herbicidal weed control. The difficult economics of today have caused many growers to seek alternatives to the cost of herbicidal weed control. Many growers are considering not using herbicides. Research has demonstrated that mechanical and cultural weed control will supplement herbicidal weed control, but there are trade-offs. Notably, the time required for mechanical weed control is greater than that required for herbicidal weed control. Also, the timeliness of mechanical weed control is more critical than that of herbicidal control. The data represent 3 rotary hoe trips and 3 cultivations for those treatments without a herbicide component. Where a herbicide is used, only 1 rotary hoe and 1 cultivation is used. Observe that when these operations are done in a timely fashion, little crop reduction is measured. However, when these operations are not timely, significant crop yield is lost. When you are considering the best method of reducing weed control costs, the best place to begin is with your application equipment and your application technique. Be sure that you are using spray nozzles that are designed to do the job that you desire, and be sure that the spray equipment is in good working order before you need it. One practice that you can adopt that will guarantee a savings in weed control costs is to calibrate your spray equipment. There are two primary goals in calibration: accuracy and uniformity. The accuracy determines that you are applying the proper amount of herbicide to achieve the weed control desired. The uniformity ensures that you are applying that herbicide in the proper manner and distributing it evenly, thus reducing the probability of crop injury, herbicide carryover, or environmental problems. By calibrating your spray equipment, you will likely save a minimum of $2 per acre sprayed. It is important that you spend the time and properly calibrate the equipment. Don't take shortcuts. The proper technique is outlined on most herbicide labels, spray equipment catalogs, and the Cooperative Extension Weed Science Publications also has this information. In summary, there are many things that you can do to achieve cost-effective weed control. The main consideration should be to plan ahead. Objectively evaluate your weed control needs, the time that you can dedicate to weed control operations, your skills as a grower, and the fiscal resources available. You do not need to use the same weed control plan for each field. In fact, it's better that you plan and develop a weed control program for each field separately from all others. You may find that you have time to cultivate a certain number of acres. Consider banding a herbicide over the row on these acres, thus saving one-half the herbicide cost. Remember to include the cost of your time when calculating weed control costs. Avoid weed control operations which do not pay for themselves. Spot treatments for weed control later in the growing season does not replace more timely treatments. Weed control at this time is strictly for aesthetics. Growers will often rationalize that they are reducing the number of weed seeds in the soil with these late treatments. Research suggests that the number of seeds kept from the soil is insignificant compared to the seeds already in the soil. Plan your weed control program to best meet your needs. Consider the amount of weed control that is necessary and the amount of weed control that you can afford. Whether you control weeds with herbicides or tillage is not important. It is important to be timely and efficient. You can hedge against costly mistakes which are the result of uncooperative weather by selecting control strategies in advance and having a backup planned. And remember, control only the weeds necessary to ensure that you have the best potential crop yield.
The first contact, the most important position in any organization. For more than 80 years, Iowans have turned to Iowa State University for help with problems and continuing education needs. University Extension Program units strive to meet those needs through work with farm operators and others associated with agriculture, families, youth, communities, business and industry, and the professions relating to the seven colleges of Iowa State University. The state of Iowa is University Extension's campus. Credit and non-credit programs are taught through both distance learning modes and throughout the state by ISU staff in the traditional classroom setting. Four program units are combined under University Extension at Iowa State University. Local, state, and federal funds are sources of support, along with fees from program participants. The four major program units which make up University Extension are Cooperative Extension Service, Center for Industrial Research and Service, Engineering Extension Service, and the Office of Continuing Education. The Cooperative Extension Service is the oldest of the four units within University Extension. Four program areas make up the cooperative unit: agriculture and natural resources, home economics, 4-H and youth, and community development and public affairs. Dr. Robert L. Crom, Dean of University Extension, is also the Director of Cooperative Extension. Working closely with him are the four state program leaders. Dr. Jerry DeWitt is program leader of the Agriculture and Natural Resource Program. Though farm producers make up only 3% of the nation's population, they're responsible for feeding much of the world. Advanced technology and the computer revolution continue to enter into much of each farm operation. With the new technology comes new programs developed in farm production, management, and marketing. Education in financial planning, use of agricultural chemicals, minimum tillage techniques, and development of software programs and databases to serve the needs of farm operations are all part of the agricultural program. Cooperative Extension continues to inform and educate the public in regard to natural and environmental resources of Iowa. Soil conservation, erosion control, water quality, and land use are just a few of the topics covered within the program area of agriculture and natural resources. From the beginning, home economics and family living programs have been an important part of Cooperative Extension. Headed by Dr. Betty Elliott, the home economic program goal is the improvement of the quality of life for individuals and families. Pressures brought to bear on families as a result of social and economic change have made them an object of much concern. The Cooperative Extension strengthens families through research and education by helping the people of Iowa to make better use of their money and economic resources, limit energy use, and protect home and community environments, follow safe, economical, and healthful nutritional practices, and by helping people to adjust to family life changes. 4-H is the youth education area of the Cooperative Extension Service. The program leader for 4-H and youth in Iowa is Dr. Jerry Parsons. The mission of 4-H is to assist youth in acquiring knowledge, developing life skills, and forming attitudes that will enable them to become self-directing, productive members of society. 4-H'ers keep written records and make oral presentations of their projects, thus developing practical lifelong management abilities and communication skills. They also gain understanding of citizenship and leadership responsibilities through involvement in projects and in community service activities. 4-H is one of Extension's most effective and successful components in terms of transferring knowledge, technology, and leadership skills to the local level. Community development and public affairs, the fourth and final program area within Cooperative Extension. Led by Dr. Ronald Powers, this area conducts educational projects within the cities and towns of Iowa. Vigorous communities and community leadership, profitable businesses, a prosperous agriculture and vital organizational leadership are the goals of community development. These goals are reached by active involvement with citizens of the Iowa communities and continued research and interpretation of data collected. Educational activities in all the four areas of Cooperative Extension, agriculture and natural resources, home economics, 4-H and youth, and community development are utilized in each county in Iowa through a program development process that reflects local concerns and needs. The Center for Industrial Research and Service, also referred to as CIRIS, is the second of the four major program units that make up University Extension. Directed by David Swanson, CIRIS helps owners and managers of manufacturing firms make better decisions by supplying them with technical and management information. Through CIRIS, the resources of Iowa State University, its faculty and research, are brought to bear on the many problems and opportunities that confront management of Iowa industries. The CIRIS mission is to help Iowa industry prosper while providing a rewarding, productive, and safe working environment for the citizens of Iowa. CIRIS field representatives operate from permanent bases located at Cedar Rapids, Creston, Davenport, Des Moines, Spencer, and Waterloo to maintain close and continuous relationships with Iowa clientele. The field representatives, reinforced by the on-campus CIRIS staff, ensure that the expertise of Iowa State University, professional associations, and private consultants is available to all who require assistance. Engineering Extension Service, the third major program unit of University Extension. Directed by Owen Osborne, Engineering Extension Service provides engineering professionals with the tools to cope with the technical knowledge explosion. This is accomplished through the use of conferences, short courses, workshops, seminars, and videotape credit courses. Programs are offered on campus and at other locations where engineers live and work. The Engineering Extension Service also provides skill-building programs for managers and supervisors in business, industry, and government. Special training and services are provided for firefighters, custodians, and electronic technicians. Publications, technical assistance, and public programs on energy conservation and renewable resources are available through the Engineering Extension Service. The Office of Continuing Education, the fourth and final unit of University Extension. Headed by Dr. Audrey Anderson, the Office of Continuing Education provides leadership in the development and supervision of non-credit short courses and off-campus credit courses. Undergraduate and graduate credit courses, the Bachelor of Liberal Studies, and master's degree programs are available off-campus wherever there is a minimum enrollment. Modern communications equipment has opened up additional capabilities to bring offerings to people almost anywhere in the state of Iowa. In order to serve the diverse educational needs of Iowa's population, the office can arrange on or off-campus presentations of conferences, workshops, short courses, and seminars on any subject appropriate to Iowa State University.
Programs may originate within departments, through private or public groups, or through individuals. We have just covered the four major units of University Extension: Cooperative Extension, Center for Industrial Research and Service, Engineering Extension Service, and the Office of Continuing Education. The real secret of University Extension is teamwork, both within University Extension and within the total university. University Extension would have little to deliver to the people of Iowa if not for the cooperation and input of the academic departments and colleges. It is there that the research and knowledge resides, and it is there where we develop our competence to deliver quality educational programs. The goal of University Extension is to serve people, to serve the state of Iowa in its needs, whether they be economic development, improving quality of life, or improving the future of our children.
In view of today's farm economy, it is more important than ever to make good crop disease management decisions. Field crop diseases can cause annual losses of 5 to 10%, and under certain conditions in specific locations, can cause losses of up to 50 to 100%. Field crop diseases may also cause indirect losses through reduction in product quality, replanting costs, fungicide application costs, and so forth. In this program, we will concentrate on how you can manage your field crop diseases to increase profitability and minimize risk. In order for you to make good decisions on managing field crop diseases, you need to know what the disease is and all possible options for controlling that specific disease. First, let's spend a little time going through these two points in a general fashion, explaining terminology and basic concepts. Then, using Phytophthora root rot of soybeans as a specific example, I'll show you how to use this information to make decisions on managing this specific field crop disease. First, it's important to accurately identify the disease involved and to have basic information on that particular disease. In order to identify a plant disease, it is necessary to make observations on the symptoms caused by the disease. The term symptom simply refers to the damage a pathogen causes to a plant. Symptoms may range from distinct spots on leaves to a mold-like growth covering the leaf. Symptoms also include yellowing of plants, stunting of plants, wilting of plants, or even death of part of a plant or the entire plant. Symptoms on above-ground portions of the plant are very easy to see, but symptoms may also occur on portions of the plant beneath the ground or in internal plant tissues. It is important to carefully dig up the affected plants to check the root systems for rotted, discolored, stunted, or abnormal roots. It is also important to split stems or crowns open to check for internal discoloration, deterioration, or other symptoms of disease. When making observations on symptoms, consider the distribution of symptoms on the individual plants as well as within the field. For example, on the individual plants, are symptoms confined to lower, older leaves, to younger, upper leaves, or do they occur over the entire plant? Is there an identifiable pattern to the symptoms within the field? Does the damage occur in low, poorly drained areas or on exposed slopes? Are symptoms more severe on plants at the edge of the field? Can you relate damage to any other practice, such as tillage, herbicide use, or planting depth? Once you have made observations on symptoms and the pattern of symptoms on individual plants and within the field, it should be possible to use extension bulletins or other reference books, or to consult with county or area extension agriculturists to identify the disease. Once you have accurately identified the disease, it is possible to look up basic information on that particular disease cycle. Specifically, there are four points you should consider. First, it is important to know how the original infection occurred. Was the pathogen carried in or on the seed? Was the pathogen present in the soil or in residue left in the field? Was the pathogen carried in on equipment, or was the pathogen blown in by wind or splashed in by rain? Second, how does the pathogen spread during the growing season? Is the pathogen spread by splashing rain or water, by wind, by equipment, or is the pathogen spread by insects? Third, what environmental factors favor disease development? In order for a plant disease to occur, it is necessary to have a susceptible plant, the pathogen, and environmental conditions which favor disease development. For example, many of the leaf spot and leaf blight diseases are favored by warm, wet, or humid weather. If the weather remains hot and dry, such foliage diseases are unlikely to develop, even if the pathogen is present and the plants are a susceptible variety. Fourth, how does the pathogen survive from season to season? Does the pathogen survive in the soil, or does it survive in infested residue left on the soil surface? Does it survive in soil on your equipment, or does it survive in or on the seed? Does it survive in weed hosts or in insect vectors? Or does it survive in southern climates and is then carried back into our area each season by insect vectors or air currents? Accurately identifying the disease involved and knowing basic information on how the original infection occurred, how the disease spreads, what factors favor disease development, and how the pathogen survives from season to season provide the information necessary to make profitable and effective control decisions. In the introduction, I stated that in order to make good decisions on managing field crop diseases, you need to know the disease involved and all possible options for controlling that disease. We've already discussed the importance of accurately identifying the disease involved and of knowing basic information on that disease. Now let's consider possible options or means of controlling plant diseases. There are certain definite practices which can be used to control plant diseases. However, the effectiveness, practicality, and profitability of employing these practices will vary with the disease and with each individual grower's setup. The basic strategies for controlling plant diseases include site selection, variety selection, planting practices, management practices, and harvest and storage practices. Let's look at each one of these strategies more closely, the first being site selection. Site selection can be broken into three major areas. Being aware of these three areas will help you to minimize or eliminate disease problems. Using your knowledge of soil types in a field, drainage or soil moisture within a field, and rotation history of a field can help you minimize or eliminate disease problems. The next area to consider is variety selection. Variety selection means being aware of a variety's susceptibility or resistance to plant diseases likely to occur in your area. Varieties with resistance to many of our common field crop diseases are available. The use of resistant varieties can be a very effective and practical means of minimizing losses due to plant diseases. The next area to consider is your planting practices. Planting practices include seed quality, soil conditions at planting, planting date, planting populations, and planting depth. These planting practices will influence rate of emergence, vigor of seedlings, stand establishment, and can also influence likelihood of disease development. Good seed quality, proper soil conditions for planting, and optimum planting date, depth, and population can help minimize incidence and severity of many plant diseases. Proper management practices will also help in controlling plant diseases. These management practices include proper fertility, residue management, insect control, weed control, and pesticide application. Generally speaking, maintaining a balanced fertility at levels recommended for your crop and site can minimize plant diseases. Crops stressed by excess or deficient nutrient levels are more prone to disease and may be more severely affected by disease. Residue management can have a direct and very important effect on disease development. If minimum tillage or residue cover is desired for conservation reasons, crop rotation and variety selection become very important in managing certain field crop diseases. Both insect and weed control can influence disease development. Some diseases are actually spread by insects. Soybean mosaic virus can be introduced into a field or spread within a field by aphids. Some pathogens are more likely to invade a plant around sites of insect damage. Some of the kernel rot fungi are more severe on ears damaged by insects. Stalk rots may be more severe if corn has been damaged by insects. Weeds, especially perennial weeds, may serve as alternate hosts and means of overwinter survival for plant pathogens. Some virus diseases survive the winter in weed hosts and then are spread to crop plants by insects the next season. High weed populations may affect the environment around crop plants by shading the plants or reducing air movement around the crop plants, thus causing environmental conditions more favorable for disease development. Good insect and weed control can contribute to good disease control. Pesticide application would involve the use of a specific pesticide to control a plant disease. This might include seed treatments, soil treatments, foliar treatments, or harvest and storage treatments. In any case of pesticide application, it is extremely important to choose a pesticide that is effective and labeled for the crop and disease in question. Proper identification of the disease is essential to proper fungicide selection. Many of the pesticides used in plant disease control must be used as preventatives, so scouting fields on a regular basis to monitor for disease problems is important. All pesticides should be applied at label rates and following label directions. Calibration of application equipment and good application techniques are crucial for good control. Prompt harvest and proper storage of field crops can also help minimize losses and reduce quality problems caused by diseases. It is important to remember that the best control strategy is one which combines a number of the practices just described into an integrated management program designed to minimize disease loss and control cost while maximizing yield and profitability. Relying on a single practice to control a field crop disease can have disastrous consequences. Let's go back through these points using a specific field crop disease as an example. Phytophthora root and stem rot of soybeans is a common problem throughout the state. So in our original outline, let's use Phytophthora root and stem rot of soybeans for the disease involved. First, the disease involved, Phytophthora root and stem rot. Second, the symptoms. Phytophthora may occur at any time during the growing season. It can cause a seed rot or pre-emergence damping off of seedlings. The most typical symptoms of Phytophthora are those of the seedling blight phase. Infected seedlings yellow, wilt, and die. Older plants may also show symptoms. Individual plants may turn off color or yellow, wilt, and die prematurely. Generally, affected plants will have a brown discoloration on the stem beginning near the soil line and moving up the stem. Seed rot and seedling blight tend to be more severe in low areas, poorly drained areas, wet areas, or compacted areas within a field. Later in the season, symptoms may occur on individual plants throughout the field. There were four questions relating to disease development that we need to consider for Phytophthora root rot. First, how did the original infection occur? Phytophthora is a soil-borne fungus which survives in the soil or in infested crop residues in the soil. The fungus may survive long periods without soybeans. Second, how does the pathogen spread during the growing season? Although there may be some spread of Phytophthora in soil water, Phytophthora does not spread much during the growing season. The fungus is present in the soil or in residues in problem fields, so root and stem rot may develop wherever or whenever environmental conditions are favorable for the disease. Third, what environmental conditions favor disease development? Phytophthora root rot is most severe in low, poorly drained, heavy soils, but it may also appear in lighter soils and on higher ground if the soil remains wet for several days. Fourth, how does the pathogen survive from season to season? Phytophthora survives in the soil or in residues left in the field. Information on Phytophthora root and stem rot of soybeans can be found in a number of Extension bulletins or reference books, or obtained during Extension meetings and from Extension personnel. Now let's consider the means of controlling Phytophthora root and stem rot, the first being site selection. Site selection can be very important in controlling or managing Phytophthora. Phytophthora is more severe in low, poorly drained, heavy soils. Therefore, it is possible to identify fields with histories of Phytophthora problems or to predict fields which are likely to have Phytophthora problems. If such fields must be planted to soybeans, the other options for controlling Phytophthora become increasingly important. The second area is variety selection. Variety selection can have a major impact on incidence and severity of Phytophthora root rot. Soybean varieties are usually considered to be susceptible, field tolerant, or resistant to Phytophthora. There are between 30 to 40 races of Phytophthora, with races 1, 3, and 4 being most common in Iowa. Resistant soybean varieties contain genes which give that variety resistance to a specific race or combination of races of Phytophthora. Field tolerance is a broader-based field resistance to all races. Information on the resistance of a variety is given in the ISU Iowa Soybean Yield Test report and is available for most seed companies and dealers. Third, as discussed earlier, planting practices include seed quality, soil conditions at planting, planting dates, planting populations, and planting depths. Planting practices can influence the severity of Phytophthora root and stem rot. Good quality seed with a high germination rate and varieties which are strong emergers tend to have lower levels of seed rot and damping off. Planting early in cool, wet soils can lead to more severe Phytophthora problems. Planting deep, particularly in cool, wet soils, can also lead to more severe phytophthora problems. Remember, management practices include proper fertility, residue management, insect control, weed control, and pesticide application. Proper fertility may have some effect on phytophthora root and stem rot. Balanced fertility at recommended rates will help minimize phytophthora. High chloride fertilizers, manure, or other organic supplements added just prior to planting may increase the severity of phytophthora. When susceptible varieties are planted in no-till or conservation tillage systems, phytophthora is more severe. Planting tillage operations to minimize residues left on the soil surface at planting, to improve soil drainage, and to minimize soil compaction will reduce phytophthora. Pesticide application is a relatively new area of phytophthora control. The fungicide metalaxyl is effective against water mold fungi such as Pythium and Phytophthora. Metalaxyl is available for use as a seed treatment or soil treatment. As a seed treatment, metalaxyl is sold under the trade name of Apron. Apron seed treatment should provide protection against Pythium and Phytophthora seed decay, pre-emergent stamping off, and seedling blight. As a soil treatment, metalaxyl is sold under the trade name of Ritamil. Ritamil is available in granular or emulsifiable concentrate formulations and is broadcast, banded, or placed in the furrow at planting. Ritamil should provide protection against early season seed decay and seedling blight, as well as late season infection in older plants. The final point to consider is harvest and storage practices. Harvest and storage practices do not have any effect on phytophthora root rot. We have stressed that the best control strategy is one which combines a number of these options into an integrated management program. We have just seen that site selection, variety selection, planting practices, residue management, and pesticide application are the most important options to consider in controlling phytophthora root rot. Selecting a well-drained site with no history of phytophthora may be sufficient to eliminate or avoid losses due to phytophthora. However, if less desirable sites must be used, then it is important to use variety selection, planting practices, residue management, and fungicide treatments to minimize losses due to phytophthora. A combination of resistant varieties and good tillage practices should minimize losses. If varieties with field tolerance rather than specific race resistance are used, the fungicide treatments should be considered. During this program, I've tried to emphasize a procedure for making good crop disease management decisions. The first step is to accurately identify the disease causing the problem. The second step is to consider all possible control options and to select from that list those that can be used most effectively, economically, and practically in a given situation. Tailoring such an integrated control program for your particular situation should allow you to reduce losses while increasing profitability and minimizing risk.